Discovery Group, covering the software sector at B. Riley FBR. I'm really pleased to welcome you to our call with Telenav Management. Before I get started, I do need to tell you the following. In the normal course of business, B. Riley FBR Capital Markets seeks to perform investment banking and other services for companies under coverage and to receive compensation in connection with such services. As such, investors should assume that B. Riley FBR intends to seek investment banking and other business relationships with any and all companies mentioned today. Telenav currently is, or within the past 12 months, was a client of B. Riley FBR or any of its affiliates. B. Riley FBR and its affiliates has received compensation from the company for non-investment banking services in the past 12 months and expects to receive and intends to seek compensation for investment banking services for Telenav in the next 3 months. Additionally, B. Riley FBR acts as a market maker and a liquidity provider for Telenav Inc. securities. So now that that's over with today, we are pleased to have with us TNAV's co-founder and COO, Sal, as well as the CFO, Adil. We really appreciate you guys joining us today, spending the time. Their opinions are their own, though, to be sure, and not to necessarily be reflective of B. Riley FBR. We ask them to also to avoid any disclosure of confidential non-public information. And with that, again, TNAV as a provider of a connected car and other location-based solutions. Management has really been generous here enough to give us some time to test drive the company's VIVID infotainment solution today for the first time. After a 15 to 20 minute demo, we're going to dive into a fireside chat to discuss the VIVID offering in some further detail. And with that, I'll hand things over to Sal. If you want to get things off and get started with the demo, that'd be great. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you, Josh. So the way we'll do the presentation, the demo is through a presentation. We have recorded videos of an actual product that we have, the actual VIVID product that we are right now betaing in the aftermarket on top of an aftermarket head unit. So I'll jump off of HP's fireside chat that was not too long ago, where he laid out the overall Telenav strategy. Which is defined as a flywheel, where the first arc of the wheel is in-car software and services. The second one is in-car commerce and monetization. And the third one is road intelligence. And each of them benefit the other and create a flywheel effect, and I'll talk to that. And VIVID is the foundation of that because it embodies all those three arcs of the flywheel. It's in-car software and services delivered through the head unit. It replaces, to some degree, what OEMs currently build themselves for the head unit. It incorporates in-car commerce, so that's a key pillar of the infotainment system. And it incorporates OpenTerra to learn about the roads and improve the information that we provide to the user, and also improve our cost of goods. So with that, let me go into the agenda, short agenda. We're gonna talk about the challenges that users and OEMs face with current IVIs today. And these are the main reasons why we built VIVID and how our approach is different. And then what the actual solution is, the VIVID solution to address these challenges. So current challenges with IVI. At Telenav, we have a saying called that we always start with the user. So if you look at the end user that's using infotainment, what you'll find is that there's very low satisfaction in general. People don't like their infotainment system because they're not intuitive, they're slow and sluggish in performance, and they lack the connected services that users typically want when they get into the car. If I'm listening to Pandora on my phone, I get into my car, I want to just magically transfer to the head unit and be able to play it right through my car. That does not happen today. So that's something that users want. And even for, if you look at the chart on the right, certainly the satisfaction with OEM systems is low. Even if you look at Android Auto and CarPlay, that brings some of those connected services, even then the satisfaction is low. And so we're here to address that problem for the user. And we have a unique approach to doing that, and I'll talk to that. Number two is it is expensive for OEMs to develop, maintain, and operate these infotainment systems. There was a study and an opinion that McKinsey put out last year where they said, you know, it's a trap. You know, the OEMs are trapped in a maze of complexity because there are just so many different systems that need to be pulled together from within the car and in the cloud that it is a very complex piece of software to build. And usually it takes 3 years to develop with several hundred engineers that are developing the software and releasing it. And that software will last, that infotainment platform will last for about 5 years. And then they go through that cycle again and again. And it's, you know, from our experience, it's a painful process to build this, get this out. And as we look at the latest technologies that we're using here in Silicon Valley, we think that with those, the new development approaches, we can solve this problem in a different way. And we'll talk to that. So let's go back to the user, the first problem, which is why users are unhappy. And our approach is, number one, to have a very easy to use, delightful experience. So anybody gets into the car, looks at it and is wowed by it upon first glance, and then finds it very easy to use, and all their connected services are built right in. So this is what our VIVID aftermarket product looks like today. Again, this is just to beta test our product and to refine and learn from it, from a user base that this is available to. And upon first glance, you see it is very simple. It looks like, you know, a normal car that you can get off the lot today. And it has a map, it has some music player, and so on. But what's unique here is the design is simple because that's what people want. But the power of the cloud behind is what's bringing cloud services in and making it easier for users, as I'll show with voice recognition and so on. So I'll play a quick video that showcases a little bit of the mapping and the cloud connected music. This is being streamed from the cloud. These are the same playlists that I have on my phone that are now available in the car in a safe and usable manner. I can control my music. I can heart or favorite it. And when I heart or favorite it, it updates it in the cloud as well. So when I get back on my phone, it is up to date. Voice recognition has been one of the biggest challenges in the car. When you're driving, you really don't want to be touching the screen. You want a robust voice recognition system that has natural language understanding to be able to then interface with the car while you're driving. Change music, find destinations to go to, and so on. So what we've done there is we've integrated Alexa into VIVID such that not only do you get access to all of Alexa's abilities at home, for example, in the car, I could say, turn on living room lights. Okay, they didn't turn on. But you can also control everything in the car.
Alexa, play Imagine Dragons.
Playing songs by Imagine Dragons from Pandora.
So here you didn't have to tell Amazon, which music player I'm playing.
Play my audiobook.
It knew it.
Getting
it was Pandora.
Selection from Audible. Resuming New York 2140.
This hadn't changed, as she never lost an opportunity to point out. Maybe she too was playing her part, but she had been dealt a great hand this time. It seemed.
Alexa, stop. Alexa, what's the weather in Los Angeles right now?
Right now in Los Angeles, California, it's 72 degrees Fahrenheit with clear skies. Today's forecast has lots of sun, with a high of 88 degrees and a low of 61 degrees.
Alexa, search for gas stations.
Here are a few ones. One, the San Francisco Marathon, 1.3 miles away on Embarcadero in Mission Street. 2. Dogpatch Biofuels.
Navigate to number 4.
Getting directions to Shell at 388 Potrero Avenue.
So there you saw a number of things. A cloud voice assistant, Alexa, that's integrated in. She can control the entire experience in the car and bring those cloud services in, like Pandora. I saw Audible, a weather service, and then navigation with traffic, all controlled through voice. And then here is an example of what a delightful experience can look like and what users want. Usually you'll find very bland icons, small fonts, and so on. What we've done is try to make the experience a little bit more lively, much like what you may find on a phone or a tablet, a little bit muted because you are in an environment where you can't focus too much, but big icons, big fonts, and so on, to make it, again, very easy to use compared to what's out there. So here I can get my suggested playlist, my personalized playlist, various radio channels, and so on, all through the car interface. Nice album art. Multiple sources of connected music, streaming music. No limitations on browsing playlists and so on. All of that accessible also through Alexa again. So again, everything, the key services that you want in the car that are coming from the cloud are very seamlessly integrated into the experience. We've talked about in-car commerce, which is a new category, a new domain for infotainment. Here's our take on it. All integrated within VIVID. You can purchase from your favorite brands on the go through speech recognition or touch. Your previous orders are saved so that you can simply go back and recall those and replace those orders again very quickly, just with a few clicks. So that's what we're doing for the user. That's today, that's available today as a beta. Going forward, we have other things that we have planned, more cloud services that as we talk to users, they want to see. Things in the rear seat, like video, and we're working on those. VIVID also addresses the other side of the coin, which is the challenges that OEMs have. And it does so with a turnkey IVI solution. So instead of taking 3 years to build from scratch, we have a turnkey solution that gets the OEM going. What does that mean? That means that we've already pre-developed the key apps, navigation, commerce, media, car control, productivity. So we've pre-developed the touch interface, we've pre-developed the voice interface, we've stitched those two together. So all that business logic and code is pre-done already for the OEM. They don't have to take a year and a half, 2 years to build that. They get that head start. And then on top, we have a customizable reference HMI, which is a user interface, where we provide that source code to the OEM or a tier one that they can then customize to their liking. So they're focused on the look and feel of the product, but the guts of it, how the flow of the application will be, we will provide. This platform supports the key OSs that are out there in the market, Android, QNX being the primary ones, and also scales from low-end hardware to high-end hardware so that to bring cloud services and this delightful experience, you don't have to have high-end hardware. You can have entry-level, mid-level hardware that you can then deploy VIVID on, albeit with fewer services. As I showed earlier, the voice assistants are built in, Alexa and Serence. We've also built in the cloud profile and personalization so that OEMs don't have to build that. They can get that user information, that data, right from our cloud, where all the profile and personalization information, logging information is there, and then use our analytics to understand the users better to provide new services. In addition to core cloud services, we've also integrated third-party services like Pandora, Yelp, Audible, et cetera, as you saw. So now you've got the core services like speech and also third-party cloud services, content services like Pandora, Yelp, all in one package, so you don't have to integrate, the OEM doesn't have to integrate them. And as Pandora, Yelp, et cetera, upgrade their APIs in the cloud, we take care of that, so the OEMs don't have to worry about maintaining all of that. And if needed, we support also a third-party app store on Android, for example, that can allow further apps that are not already pre-integrated. And then finally, the business model is SaaS or licensing, and very low NRE upfront. So today, you know, before the first car ships, OEMs spend tens, if not hundreds of millions of dollars to build software for those vehicles. With VIVID, that is cut by a significant amount. So there are upfront savings. And then also our platform, we've made it easy for them such that they can license it on a SaaS model going forward. In addition to our change in NRE, in our impact on NRE and licensing costs and SaaS, we've also built in monetization opportunities like in-car commerce, where drivers spend $230 billion during the commute and enable OEMs to tap into that. So if I pick up a cup of coffee every morning where I have to pull up to the drive-thru, place the order, wait, and so on, versus as I'm driving, I get a notification on the head unit, would you like your regular coffee along the route to work? You simply click that and get that order as soon as you arrive rather than having to wait. So building those convenience services, and then on the flip side, building a monetization model for the OEMs to monetize those transactions. So we've built in in-car commerce. We've built in insurance, an insurance offering where, again, through better driving, through analyzing the driving behavior, we can suggest a better insurance rate working with the insurance company. So that's another opportunity that we're actively engaged in. And finally, our business model is very OEM-centric. So the OEM owns the user data and the relationship. We are an enabler to enhancing that relationship, but they're always in control. So this is, in a nutshell, is VIVID and how we address OEM problems. So to summarize, for users, what VIVID does, three things. It's easy to use and a delightful UX. It's a fast, snappy interface, and most of the popular digital services are built in. For OEMs, we enable fast time to market, low cost, yet it's a bespoke solution that reflects their brand. We've built in the cloud services that are popular already, and we've built in the monetization so that the overall cost of an infotainment is a lot less. And over time, as you monetize in-car commerce, insurance, others, it actually becomes a profit center for the OEMs. And then finally, if you look at the flywheel, VIVID sits in the in-car software and services arc there, but it has in-car commerce, it has road intelligence built in. So it really serves as the foundation of our offerings and pulls them all together in one cohesive solution. That's it. I'll pass that back to you.
Sal, thanks for taking the time to go over that. Good to see VIVID live for the first time for me personally, outside of like a quick brief demo at CES. Could you provide a couple of things I was thinking of while going over this presentation? One is like, What are kind of the primary differentiators between like Vivid and a competitor, say like Google's Gas, right? And is there anything that that Gas offers that Vivid does not? How would you compare and contrast those two?
So I'll start at the highest level, which is what it means for the OEM. And our solution, as I mentioned, is OEM centric. So the data, the experience is fully owned by the OEM. Versus our understanding is with Gas, that may not be the case, that there are several restrictions, both business and from a product perspective, that won't enable that. So that's a big difference, is we are for the OEM and we provide them full control. That's number one. From a user perspective, you've got very similar offerings where you have a competitive map offering, you've got a competitive speech offering, you've got the apps that you want. So from a user perspective, it's quite competitive. Another big difference is that we're available across multiple OSs, like I mentioned, where Gas is primarily, from our understanding, limited to Android. We support the other popular operating systems that are there, QNX, automotive grade Linux. So that opens up the market for us to the entire base of the auto industry versus just the footprint that's using Android. We also scale from, like I said, low to high across operating systems. So that's everything. I would say those are the main differences. Business model, user services are about the same, and we just have a larger footprint from an auto industry to address.
Mm-hmm. What do you think the primary advantage for an OEM to choose Vivid over, you know, like an Android Auto or CarPlay? Is it the retention of the relationship and the data, or specifically, or is it just a blend of several things as you kind of alluded to before?
So the main benefit, of course, is for the OEM to have that relationship, but also from a user perspective. You know, today a lot of these things are beamed sort of out of my phone, and if connectivity drops or something happens with that connection, I lose my infotainment system. I'm hearing of it more and more. You know, just Google Waze crashing in Android Auto or CarPlay. It's happening more and more, because it's a very complex system. Versus here, the default system, what we've done with the OEM default infotainment system is bring that same experience with the reliability and the quality that you'd expect from a vehicle. So if you're out of coverage, things still work, for example. The challenge has been, again, that it hasn't, you know, the gaps have been not easy to use, digital services not present. So once you solve that, you then have people engaging with the product. And if you look at Tesla, they're a prime example of this. They've built a wonderful experience. And if you ask users, they're very satisfied with that. They're not looking for something else. So if OEMs can then deliver a Tesla-like experience, let's call it, then there's no need to go to CarPlay, Android Auto, because it's all there, it's reliable, it's fast, and it does everything that you want it to do. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're enabling.
And then, so Telenav has like a really interesting opportunity to really capture or take some market share in this like 60 to 70% of lower trim vehicles with this new like beta infotainment system that you guys have been building out for a little while now. I guess like one, like your ability to dislodge like Android Auto and CarPlay, do you expect to capture a fairly significant portion of this market? And how long do you think that may take since this product is currently still in beta?
Sure. So, you know, the OEM head units, I'll start with OEM infotainment systems, they're going to live side by side with Android Auto CarPlay. You know, it's not like you can ship a car which says plug in your phone and then I'm going to show you an infotainment experience. You'll need to have a default infotainment experience. And depending on how good it is, it'll either keep people there, or people will then, you know, flee to the other parallel over the top infotainment systems. So we expect the OEM infotainment systems to continue to exist. And in terms of timeframes, as I mentioned, what we have right now is a beta. And the purpose of this beta is to refine the experience, learn about new use cases, and build a delightful experience. That's what the purpose of the beta is. We have in parallel another initiative, which is creating the production grade VIVID SDK that we will then give to the OEMs to build their infotainment system on top of, along with their reference HMI. And that we expect to ship, make available and ship to an OEM completely by the end of our fiscal year, 21.
So June, you said June of 21?
By June, we'll be able to give an SDK to an OEM that they can then build on.
And then on recent calls, the management teams also talked a bit about really there's a big opportunity in China to increase the company's presence on that front. What's been done on that front so far? Are you seeing a lot of traction? Some OEMs and other players have had more or less success in that space. And how material do you think China is going to be as far as for the company and a revenue generator in the next like 12 or 24 months?
Mm-hmm. So I'll address some of that. And then maybe Adil can address the how much it'll generate in the next 24 months. Clearly China is the largest opportunity, largest automotive market in this space. Also very, very dynamic. A lot of changes happening there, much faster than what we're seeing in the rest of the world. So it continues to be a focus. We have a dedicated team, a large dedicated team that's focused just on China to cater to the OEMs there. We certainly see infotainment, the approach we've taken with VIVID. There are others that have taken a similar approach there, like Banma. And so we know there's an appetite for turnkey, complete infotainment systems within that OEM ecosystem there. So that's that opportunity for us in the local market. And then more and more, we're seeing Chinese OEMs export out of China. And there they need a global experience, a global infotainment system, not just for the local market, but something that's for the global market. And there we see also opportunity to supply them various, either the entire infotainment system or parts of it as they go into Europe, South America, Eastern Europe, so on.
You left the tough question for a deal.
Yes.
Yeah, so I can jump in, Josh. So I think we don't really disclose by region, you know that, right? But I think China, as Sal said, it's a big market, you know, and back in, I think a couple of years ago, they shipped about 25 million units. The current year forecast is still about 22 million units. It's a huge market. It's bigger than any other market that exists across the globe. Now, what we're seeing is what Sal pointed out to is it's not only serving the Chinese OEMs for China, but also serving the Chinese OEM for outside of China. So that's where, you know, we even become more competitive and differentiated because we can not only meet their needs in China, but also outside of China. So we see OEMs shipping or exporting out to Southeast Asia. We see Chinese OEM now shipping or exporting out to Europe. So we have experience in Europe. So certainly that comes in handy. So we want to capitalize both. And we have a pipeline, we're working there. Then another thing that Sal kind of alluded to a little bit is organizationally, we have made some changes internally. And those changes are just meant for more dedicated, focused approach to China. Now we have a dedicated team that's basically just working in China for China.
And then how does the VIVID system really integrate with the build out of these other revenue opportunities like in-car commerce that you mentioned or like road intelligence, right? There's another thing as this continues to build out further.
Sure. So those are weaved right into VIVID. It's part of the experience. For example, within VIVID, we have navigation. And as you are, say you're driving within VIVID navigation, and you then ask Amazon, I'm just gonna stop saying Alexa because it's all lighting up here. But if you ask Amazon to find you something along the way, I want a cup of coffee, for example, you ask the voice assistant. It will then find the ones that are available within our commerce database that we can transact at, highlight those where you can place the order, and right from within navigation, you can then select that and be able to place an order so that you can find one along your route versus something that's behind you. So that's one example of how in-car commerce is integrated into navigation. Another example is we have a AI-based engine that learns your patterns. And that serves many different domains. So in commerce, it knows what you like when you like it. And when you get into the car and turn it on, it'll recommend that or something similar. Maybe I go to Starbucks every day, but today I get a blue bottle coffee promotion to try something new that they have. And that shows up on the home screen. So commerce is weaved through the Vivid experience. And in terms of OpenTerra and road intelligence, our navigation system, it runs, of course, on commercial, here maps, we call it, but also OpenStreetMaps, which are powered by OpenTerra for navigation quality. So that's also part of our Vivid solution.
And you, not too long ago, announced a new partnership, right, with Alpine. And is the product that you're demoing today, is that the one that's going to be sold with Alpine? Is that going to be the exact same Vivid product that you would sell to like a new OEM in the future, or are there some varying degrees of differentiation there?
Yeah, so the Alpine product, I would say, is quite similar to the video we saw, very similar experience. That product is targeted for a smaller screen device, so there are interface differences. But from a functionality perspective, you've got, you know, a voice assistant, you've got music, cloud music, and you've got cloud-based maps and nav. So functionality is very much the same as we saw today, and that's what we're shipping with Alpine, and that's what we plan to ship with OEMs. But with OEMs, there'll be more capabilities because, again, the limited footprint we had with what we could do on the Alpine product. Mm-hmm. But you cover the basics. We've definitely covered the basics well.
And then just to hit on it, since you mentioned, could you provide like one or two examples about like the customization, right, of the center stack that the OEM would be able to do to make it a proprietary, right, infotainment mm-hmm. system for them? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So anything that is visual can be customized. So I can, for example, change the color scheme, the thickness of a border, the shape of a window, the shape of a button. The text that's on there, all of that can be customized. Where I'd like to put that button, is it at the bottom, is it at the top? So any visual layout and design can be customized. It's the flow logic. You know, if you click this button, it goes here. We've hardwired that, if you will, to some degree. So that that hard part, you know, there are only so many ways you can search for a Starbucks in a nav system. We've worked through that, refined that, we know what that looks like. So instead of trying to having to recreate it every time we build a new infotainment system, we've packaged that up and we've tested it, and it's high quality. We know it works through usability testing and through our QA testing. So now they can build on top of that rather than having to recreate all of that. So that's one example.
And then just hopping back real quick to Alpine, I understand it's still early stages, but if you could kind of help frame what the economics of that might look like, and also the market opportunity for the aftermarket market, since it's a newer target that you're going after.
Mm-hmm. So I'll let Adil do some of that, again, the hard part, but to just frame it from an overall aftermarket opportunity perspective, the Alpine product in particular runs in vehicles that support mirror link technology, which allows for an external device to project and mirror a display, much like plugging in a Fire TV stick into your TV. Very similar analogy where you can plug it in and it sort of mirrors. So Mirror Link allows you to do that through a USB port. And there are tens of millions of vehicles out there today in the installed base that would be potential total market for us. So the target opportunity, the target base is large. There. And of course, as you know, with Alpine, we're targeting that base. Adil?
Yeah, so I think, Josh, we can't, you know, so obviously, you know, as you try to penetrate a new market opportunity, so for us, aftermarket is opening up an additional vertical. So we have always been embedded, you know, OEM play. So aftermarket is a new channel and a new vertical for us. So obviously, you know, there'll be a learning time and the ramp, and you know, gradually it'll scale, and we learn from our experience. So we don't expect it to be, you know, a material impact to near term, but eventually, you know, as we scale, as Sal said, there are millions of cars that are in scope and potentially a target market. And then what we are seriously looking at aftermarket opportunity, not only in Europe, but also in the US and in China.
And then what else is it really out there on the market, obviously, besides for people think about Android Auto or CarPlay, for like who else is developing something that would be kind of comparable to this, or what else is there and how would you kind of compare and contrast it aside from like the two primary competitors that most people are probably familiar with?
So certainly, you know, the perspective that we have on the market, which is being an OEM enabler and to support the OEMs, that is shared by other suppliers in the auto industry, tier ones, others as well. So there are other companies that are looking at this sort of turnkey IVI type solution that are out there. Harman being one of them. They have a product called Ignite that they're looking at, which is a cloud services platform. And there are a few others that rumblings that we hear. But you know, everything we've seen out there has a more, I'll say, a traditional approach to solving this problem versus we take a different mindset, more of a product and Silicon Valley user first mindset. So the problem we're trying to solve is the same as, you know, many suppliers trying to solve is the same, but our angle is very different and our approach is very different. And again, for us, it starts with the user experience and with the user, and then building the technologies that power that user experience, and then building those technologies in such a way that it's productized. I don't have to start from scratch, build it again, reintegrate everything. It's all pre-integrated, and it's a product rather than you know, a set of tools that need to be assembled together. So there's a different approach we're taking, which gives much better TCO to the OEM from development to maintenance to sunsetting. So across the board, we've thought through how do we reduce the cost and delight the user at the same time. And so just the approach, our mindset is different as how we're approaching.
How much time has the company spent to really develop this platform? Clearly, this Telenav has a broad history with doing like things like navigation, right? Going back to flip phones and whatnot, if you will. And how much has been invested dollar-wise also to develop to kind of gauge the competitive moat that this offering could potentially have?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so dollar question again, back to Adil. I'll talk about the product and what we've done. So we've been at it a couple of years so far, and we've gone through a number of iterations as well in that. We've learned a lot, and we've iterated and improved our thinking, improved our approach to building the product, and some of what I said is a result of that. So we've been at it for a couple of years. You see the product where it is right now. And as I mentioned, we still have a ways to go. You know, we have the next 6-9 months before we ship it. We're shipping parts of it before that to OEMs so they can start building on parts of it. But it's been an effort for 2 years and a sizable team on it. Adil?
Maybe I'll take the, thank you, Sal, once again for the tough question. So Josh, I think, you know, you can, if you look at, you know, what we have been reporting regularly for the last 3 quarters or so, we have been very disciplined about our investments and very methodical. We look at all possibilities, and VIVID is not all about, you know, organic. It's organic plus partnerships plus, you know, technology investments that we're doing. For example, if you look at, you know, Sync3, we invested in that company rather than building, you know, that platform by ourselves and going out to the restaurants and the QSRs by ourselves. We thought it would be a good way to enable our ICC platform and get access of thousands of restaurants, quick service restaurants, into our ecosystems. We made some investments into Sync3. It was build versus buy decision. Similarly, Motion Auto, which is part of our insurance offering, if you were to build something like this, it would take us, you know, maybe 3 years and then, you know, maybe 10 times more than what we ended up spending in terms of getting access to the insurance offering play, and we can start integrating it into our ecosystem. Third one, for example, Mover AI, a company that does road scoring, where you can, you know, you're driving on a freeway, it can give you a pop-up message and say, you know, slow down, there could be ice based on the road based on the weather conditions and or the DMV data and other things, right? So it scores the road. And it defines the fastest path for you. Again, build versus buy, right? Should we go and invest a tiny bit of money and quickly get access to the technology and integrate into our ecosystem as opposed to. So I think you will see us, Josh, being very disciplined about our investments. It's all return-based investment, and the fastest path with a differentiated product to the market is the core guiding principle here. And that's our approach has been to VIVID, ICC, and the overall end-to-end value chain. And we will continue to do that.
And one thing, whenever I think about connected vehicles and the adjacent services that the company could potentially provide is I start thinking about network effects. And one of the advantages is that the company does have a lot of these connected vehicles that are increasingly on the road every day. And what kind of strategic value are you really seeing from having this large source of connected cars that are on the road relative to maybe some competitors? Or what additional data and insight is that providing you that you think gives you an edge?
So, one example of that I'll share is, recently we did benchmarking of our navigation routing module, let's call it. And do we give you a fast route just as the best competitor out there, let's call it. So competitor A considered the benchmark for the market and our routing solution. Do we both get to the destination at the same time or do they get there first or second? There's a myth that, hey, company A has the best navigation solution and gets you there faster. So we wanted to put that to test. And once we did that, we saw that as we've had connected car data come through our platform and improve our routing abilities and so on, we've closed that gap significantly. That did exist in the past, but now it's not there. It's barely there. So using the data that we have that over the years that we have has helped us improve our routing, improve our search, and then also enables us, now that we have this user base, enables us to then bring new services as well to that user base. Things like in-car commerce and integrating that in to the existing products that are out there. And those are opportunities that we're looking at.
Mm-hmm. I know a lot of people still think of probably Telenav as a kind of like a royalty business a little bit, but increasingly more so it's flipping to a services business we've talked about. And I think not too long ago you mentioned that there's like actually $1 billion of revenue just from like existing customer engagements, most of which is probably going to be realized through fiscal 23. Can you just kind of briefly walk through the underlying assumptions that we have there so people can get a little bit better understanding of the pipeline for the business?
So maybe I can take that, Sal. So so Josh, so we reported that $1 billion number back in the December quarter. So I think as we said at that time, the underlying assumptions really are the short-term forecast, 12 months or beyond from OEMs, only focusing on our existing contracts that we have, the existing customer engagements we have. And then what management tries to do is, based on the OEM data and the IHS data, we try to come up with the lifetime value of those contracts and what is the lifetime value. And then you bundle it with, the deferred revenue that we have sitting on our balance sheet. And as you know, it's about $140 million or so is just in deferred revenue that's sitting on the balance sheet. So you combine all that together, and then you apply some management estimates, and that drives your backlog number. And that's the industry practice. I think that's how most of the companies are doing backlog calculation in our space today. Now, I think the bigger question that you didn't ask, Josh, is what is the impact of COVID, or could be the impact of COVID, right, on backlog, right? And that's probably where you're going. So I think as we said in the last earnings call and our March quarter, our hypothesis, talent management hypothesis, is that as a result of COVID, OEMs could be, or will be, in fact, more cost sensitive. So their willingness to switch from program A to program B will not be as high as it would have been otherwise. So we believe some of our programs, their lifetime value may go up. So certainly that becomes kind of a favorable impact to our backlog number. But at the same time, as you recognize revenue in the quarter, that becomes an unfavorable number to your backlog number. So the net of the two, we have to still size. We have to look at it, what that means. I think right now still, the short term and the long term forecast is still a little vague and muddy. Because OEMs just opened up their plants and they are still ramping up. So as we get more intelligence, certainly, when we reach a stage where we can give an update on backlog, we'll definitely give an update. But I think as you think about the pluses and minuses, I think of all those factors in mind.
Thanks. That's helpful on that front. And then last question for me. I know the company's talked about there's kind of this three-pronged approach, right, that the company has for like the long-term growth factors. And you have like the in-car software, right, and services with like things like navigation and VIVID in-car commerce, things like QSR and insurance that you've talked about. And lastly is like the road intelligence with things like OpenTerra. Could you just briefly hit on what you think is kind of like the biggest near-term opportunity for each of those, and when you think we could start to see those spool up and become more near-term opportunities?
So maybe I'll start, and then Sal, you can jump in. You know, so I'll go back to Josh, the opportunities that we pointed out at our last earnings call. There are like five big opportunities we talked about, right? And that's based on the pipeline that we have working on, and some of the, you know, the initial success that we have reported to you guys. So number one really is how can we increase our share of wallet within our existing customer base, right? So if you look at our existing customer base, can we go in and expand our share of wallet, right? Be it, because today, for example, GM predominantly operates, so we play in at the 9% of the total market, which is really the high-end Android operating system and the high-end vehicles. Now they have 70% of their, 65 to 70% of the vehicles, you know, are basically, I would say, low-end vehicles. So can we devise a solution that would cater the vast majority of the vehicles out there? Or can we go and sell ICC into our existing customer base, or insure us into our existing customer base? There are different opportunities that the teams are exploring. So number one opportunity, just to recap, is really increasing our share of wallet with an existing customer base. Number two is going after new OEMs. We need to sign up new OEMs. We did sign up, and especially in the navigation space, we did sign up a new OEM in the ICC space that we announced last quarter. But in the navigation space, we have a pipeline and different opportunities are at a different, I would say, stage of maturity. Some are getting close to maturity, and some are, you know, a little out there, because, you know, the sales cycle could be pretty long. But that's number two. We need to win new OEMs, and we will continue to win new OEMs, be it, you know, using our overall ecosystem that we're building, or VIVID, or our ICC offering, how we can differentiate and go win. So far, the feedback has been very positive. The third is really is the in-car commerce. So in-car commerce, we're just getting started. You know, we just made first announcement with this Japanese OEM. There's more to come. But we will continue to explore the in-car commerce. But we have to build the ecosystem at the same time. We need to add things, and, you know, QSRs are already there. You know, as you know, as you scale, you have to add more things to it, and we will continue to build the ecosystem. Then fourth is aftermarket. I think we talked about aftermarket. We touched on, I think we went into details of aftermarket, how it's an opportunity. We signed a deal with Alpine in Europe. And as Sal said, there are millions of cars in the aftermarket space in Europe. We see as a decent opportunity over time. We are exploring similar aftermarket opportunities in the US and also in China. So that's number four. And the last but not the least is how can we take our install base and start monetizing it, be it for insurance purposes, or as Sal said, for improving our navigation offering, or even for other things like subscriptions. And there are endless possibilities. There are different things that the teams are looking at. And I think that's one of our strengths compared to other couple of named competitors. The install base is massive, and we get a lot of intelligence from our install base.
Well, thanks. That's about all the time. I think this might be a good place to stop. We're getting on the 50-minute mark here. Once again, really appreciate you guys taking the time. I appreciate looking at getting the chance to see the VIVID demo and what that could do. I look forward to catching up later. I'll kick back to you if you have any closing remarks. But again, thank you for taking your time. That's all I have.
Oh, thank you. Thanks a lot. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. Have a good one, guys.
Thanks.